Hi, welcome to worship here at St. Mark's United Methodist Church, where we seek to change the world by caring for all people. I'm Lynn Bartlett, the lead pastor. You'll meet our other pastors, Stuart and Kim, later in the service. You'll also hear from church member Don Booth, from our choirs, and from other musicians. We are excited to welcome you to worship. Our QR code will take you to our website to register your attendance, to print a bulletin, to offer a prayer request, or to give financially. This week, we continue our series focused on the vows that we make when we become members of the church by talking about our gifts. Why do we give gifts? It's something we all do, whether we're members or not. This is also the third week of our stewardship campaign. Jesus invites us to come and see. Come and see what God is doing in the world, and come and see what we can do together to change the world through Christ. Welcome to worship. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Please join me in our opening prayer, saying with me the words that are printed on your screen. As we come to worship this day, O God, we give you thanks and praise. We are grateful for your everlasting love and give praise for your unending mercy. Remind us again of your countless gifts of love. Teach us in this time and place to find our hope in you. Tune our hearts to your grace and keep us from wandering from your goodness. We praise this in the name of Christ. Amen.
Hey friends, welcome to Children's Time. I'm so glad you're here that we get to spend this special part of worship just being us. So I want you to put your thinking caps on for a second and think of something that you're really good at. Can you do that? Think really, really hard, something you're really, really good at. Okay, I hope you have an idea, because what I want you to do is tell the people in the room you're in something that you are good at. And I'm gonna give us to the count of three, and I want you to be able to say at least one thing that you're good at to someone else. You ready? One, two, three. All right, all my friends that shared something, awesome. All my friends that listened, I now want you to do the same thing. We'll do the same counting method too. So by the time I count to three, I hope you've shared something that you are good at. You ready? One, two, three. All right, I hope you shared something that you're good at too. Because, you know, we're all good at something. We are all given gifts by God of things that we can do well. And when we know what those things are, we can practice them, we can get better at them, we can improve at them, and then we can give those gifts to other people. If you are good at an instrument, and you, what you do is you keep practicing, and you get better and better. So that when you offer music to God, or you play music in church or for your family, you're giving a gift. You're sharing from what God has given you with others. And we all have gifts that are like this, where we can practice them, we can get a little bit better, and then we can share with others and make the world a better place. So if you are thinking of something that you're really good at, or maybe something you want to get better at, practice. Do a little bit of work at it. Put in some time, put in some energy, and you'll get better. And then when you share those things, you'll get to give the gifts that you get from God of the ability to do those things, and you'll get to share it with other people and with God. So you'll get to give back from what you have been given. And that, my friends, is a big blessing for everybody. Won't you please pray with me? Loving God, we give you thanks that you make each of us special, that you give each of us gifts. Help us to work on our gifts, to improve them, so that we can share them with you and share them with those we care about. Thank you so much. And thank you for the greatest gift, your Son, Jesus. We pray all of this in his name. Amen. Thank you so much for joining me for Children's Time. I'll see you later.
Our first scripture talks about Jesus as the owner of God's kingdom and the rewards of growing that kingdom on earth. It surmises that God is not that happy with us when we are blessed with Jesus' love and don't share that love. Hear these words from Matthew chapter 25, verses 14 through 30. The kingdom is also like what happened when a man went away and put his three servants in charge of all he owned. The man knew what each servant could do. So he handed 5,000 coins to the first servant, 2,000 to the second, and 1,000 to the third. Then he left the country. As soon as the man had gone, the servant with the 5,000 coins used them to earn 5,000 more. The servant who had 2,000 coins did the same with his money and earned 2,000 more. But the servant with 1,000 coins dug a hole and had his master's money buried in the ground. Sometime later, the master of those servants returned. He called them in and asked what they had done with his money. The servant who had been given 5,000 coins brought them in with the 5,000 that he had earned. He said, "Sir, you gave me 5,000 coins and I have earned 5,000 more." "Wonderful," his master replied. "You are a good and faithful servant. I left you in charge of only a little, but now I will put you in charge of much more. Come and share with my happiness." Next, the servant who had been given 2,000 coins came in and said, "Sir, you gave me 2,000 coins and I have earned 2,000 more." "Wonderful," his master replied. "You are a good and faithful servant. I left you in charge of only a little, but now I will put you in charge of much more. Come and share in my happiness." The servant who had been given 1,000 coins then came in and said, "Sir, I know that you are hard and hard to get along with. You harvest what you don't plant and gather crops where you haven't scattered seed. I was frightened and went out and hid the money in the ground. Here is every single coin." The master of the servant told him, "You are lazy and good for nothing. You know that I harvest what I didn't plant and gather crops where I haven't scattered seed. You could have at least put my money in the bank so that I might have interest that was earned on it." Then the master said, "Now your money will be taken away and given to the servants with the 10,000 coins. Everyone who has something will be given more, and they will have more than enough. But everything will be taken from those who don't have anything. You are a worthless servant, and you will be thrown out into the dark where people will cry and grind their teeth in pain."
In our epistle lesson this morning from 2 Corinthians in chapter 9, we hear these words from Paul about what our giving does, about what our giving to God means for the world, and about God's amazing grace for us. Please hear these words from 2 Corinthians. "Remember this: whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. As it is written, 'They have freely scattered their gifts to the poor, their righteousness endures forever.' Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. This service that you perform is not only supplying the needs of the Lord's people, but is also overflowing in many of expressions of thanks to God. Because of the service by which you have proved yourselves, others will praise God for the obedience that accompanies your confession of the gospel of Christ, and for your generosity in sharing with them and with everyone else. And in their prayers for you, their hearts will go out to you because of the surpassing grace God has given you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Today, we're talking about gifts. This is the fourth portion of our vows of membership. Are you a good gift giver? There are those in the world who are, and I'm not one of them. I don't even say thank you soon enough or enough in general. If you gave me something as we came here this summer, you're aware of my lack of thank you notes. I usually catch up at Christmas, but I'm not even a good gift giver. I have friends who are, though. I'd like to introduce you to two friends of ours who are fabulous gift giver, brothers Rick and Ray Buckley. Ray is a beautiful storyteller, a Native American who believes in the mission and the work of the United Methodist Church. He's held different positions with the church over the years. I met him through his work with the Upper Rooms program, the Academy for Spiritual Formation. Some of you have participated. It's a more academic version of the Walk to Emmaus, sort of, but it's a powerful experience. There's five-day academies and two-week academies. Ray has been all over the country, all over the world as a speaker for the Upper Room. A few summers ago, our family spent 28 days in Alaska on a renewal leave. In the first 2 weeks, we saw Ray and his brother Rick 3 different days. And each day, they brought us gifts. The first day, we went to Palmer, to the farmer's market. My daughter wanted a cookie. I said no. Rick knew he wanted one, so he bought cookies for everybody. They then paid for entrance to the reindeer farm, a special spot for the two of them. And then there was this flower. Our waitress at lunch told Rick and Ray to stop in to see her before they left. We went to the car, they went to talk with her. They came out with this beautiful beaded flower that she had handmade. They wanted me to have it. It's a beautiful gift that continues to sit on my desk years later. The next time we saw them, we went to Aklutna. This is a mission established by the Russian Orthodox Church with the Athabaskan peoples. St. Nicholas Church at Aklutna is the oldest standing building in Anchorage. We met Rick and Ray there, and we enjoyed several hours together. Before we left, they gave us more gifts. Well, they paid for us to get into the church again, and they gave us a pie with the crust baked by town mother, Mother Marie Callender, and homemade whipped cream in a can. They gave us home-smoked salmon and smoked salt. They gave us calligraphy from a friend that we could give away if we needed gifts for somebody. We still have them. They gave us books from their own library. One is a book that Ray had read every single year. They gave us fossilized walrus ivory. They gave us baskets, double-walled baskets made by Rick. This one is a Three Nations design with the fur of the musk ox in the top portion. The other one is a salmon run design with a pink reed that gets darker as it goes from the top and the bottom and back up. It symbolizes the salmon as it goes from birth to sea back to death at the place of its birth. If that wasn't enough, on the last day, we stopped by their home on our way to see Denali. There, they laid out a feast of fruit and vegetables, cheese and meat and crackers, even though we all agreed we weren't dining with them that day. Finally, they brought us outside and gave our son a tooth from a moose that they had found on the edge of their property. This tooth forever reminds us of both Rick and Ray and of the best pizza we had in Anchorage or maybe ever at the Moose's Tooth restaurant. These two men, Rick and Ray, know how to give gifts. It's a part of who they are. It's a part of their identities as Tlingit natives, one of the cultural practices that defines them as a practice of lavish gift giving. They've been on the receiving end and they know how to be on the giving end. It's ingrained in them and they do it well. They didn't go to the store to buy these gifts for us. They gave us books they already owned because they thought we would enjoy them. They gave us a tooth from a moose's skull that they found because they thought it would be something that our son would enjoy and remember. They gave what they had with grace and joy. We serve a God who's a lavish gift giver too. All that we have is given to us by God. Scripture tells us that everything is God's. Everything. You and I are stewards of these things. We care for it, we use it, we share it, but ultimately all that we have is God's. We like to forget it. We like to think that we earned our money, we pulled ourselves up by our own bootstraps, that we somehow deserve what we have, or we deserve to have more than what we have. But that's not biblical. The biblical witness is from stories like our stories this morning. The story Jesus told was a pretty radical one. It tells of a master who gave his servants lavish gifts, and each of the servants did something different with it. The emphasis is on the third servant, who is condemned for failing to respond appropriately to the master's generosity. The third servant didn't use what was entrusted to him. He forgot whose money it was to begin with, and he didn't use it for anything good. We are all given lavish gifts by our God. Some of us have more money than others. Some of us have more time than others. Some of us have more focused prayer life than others. God gives to us differently. It doesn't matter what we have. It matters that we use it. Many of us live with a scarcity mentality. We're scared for our future. We're scared we won't have enough later if we give now. This isn't honoring what God has given us. We each have an abundance. Did you notice the reward for the work well done? In the parable, those who did good work were given more work to do, greater tasks, greater responsibility in the work of the master. As the talents grew in the story, so does the servant's responsibilities. As we're faithful with what we have, as we're faithful in using the gifts that God has given us, then God will ask more of us. God demands we use what we have been given. Our passage from Paul today reminds us that God loves a cheerful giver. God has blessed us so abundantly that we have everything that we need, and God loves it when we in turn bless others. That's part of our membership vows. We need your financial gifts as a church to pay the light bills and pay our staff and water the flowers and keep the air conditioner on. And God calls you to give. The Old Testament tells us to bring our tithe, the first 10% of what we make, to give to God, but not the New Testament. In the pages of the New Testament, we see time and time again how the early church gave all that they had to the work of the church. Now, I'm sure that you would all prefer I hold you to the 10% tithe instead of asking for the entire contents of your 401k. The point is, we can give with a cheerful heart or we can refuse to give. But God has already given to us, and frankly, God asks us to give to others. I am not a good gift giver. I think later of what I should have done, or I think about it, but then don't follow through. We brought pine cones home from California to send to Rick after we were there for a new basket that he wanted to make using leaves off of a pine cone. We never sent him. I bought something for my administrative assistant because I thought she'd like it. It was only a couple of dollars, and it sat in my house for 6 months before I gave it to her. We bought gifts for our staff, and it was a full 18 months before we gave them away. I'm not a good gift giver, but we serve a God who's a great gift giver and asks us to do the same. One of my favorite gifts from Ray is this. This was the first gift Ray gave to us before he was in our home, before he met our children. Ray gave us the gift of the gourd Christ. On it are two depictions of snow in Alaska. On the inside is the cosmos and walrus ivory, reminding us of the first light of creation. And in the center is the face of Christ. The face of Christ reminds us of what God gave us. The greatest gift of all, the Christmas song says, is Jesus. And that's what we see when we look to this face. Christ, who gave the ultimate gift of all, eternal life for all who believe. One of my favorite gifts from Rick is this. This is birch wood made into a cross, found from near his house. Rick has placed on it an Inukshuk. An Inukshuk is from the Inuit tribes from Canada and Alaska. This says something good happened here. As far as Ray knows, Rick is the only person he's seen to place an Inukshuk on the cross. As followers of Christ, we know that something good happened here. Not good for Christ, not good so we can feel good about it, but good because it's the greatest gift that God could give us. Both of these gifts point to the greatest gift that God gives us, the life of his Son on the cross, that we might have eternal life. As we worship today, we do so with the knowledge that we are not here to celebrate the gifts two men gave us, but to celebrate the gift of life offered through Jesus Christ our Lord. We come today knowing that something good happened here. We come knowing God's greatest gift happened on that cross. We know God has given abundantly to us. Can we give abundantly to others? Let us pray. God, thank you for the gifts that you give to us. Thank you for the gift, most especially, of eternal life. Compel us to give generously to others. Compel us to give generously to the church and the work that we do here. Compel us to give generously without a scarcity mentality. Compel us to give, not because we're told to, but because we do it out of the abundance of what you have given us. Thank you, God, for the privilege it is to give to others. In the name of Christ, who gave his life for us. Amen.
As we enter into prayer, I want to remind you of the opportunities to request prayer. You can use the QR code that's on your screen now. There you can tap on prayer request and submit a request. Similarly, you can go to our website, umcstmarks.org, click on resources in the upper right-hand corner of the page, and then scroll down to prayer requests. You can also send an email to info@umcstmarks.org. We invite your prayers. I invite you now to listen to this music as we prepare ourselves for prayer. Please pray with me. God, we come to you today as people who have received many gifts from you. The gift of life, of family and friends, and the gift of being able to worship freely. We know that as with other gifts, all those come with responsibility. And so, Lord, we give you our gratitude and thanksgiving for all that you have given us. We lift up those in our community who continue to heal, including Laura, Charlotte, Clay, and Julie. Forgive us for the time that we've hoarded our gifts and our blessings, for the times when we've expected your love, but not shared that love with others. Lord, you've given your love time and time again, and yet we are sometimes neglectful in our responsibility to give back through our gifts and our concern for others. May we use our skills and resources to do your work. Remind us that what you require of us is no more than we are capable of, that you have given each of us talents that we don't even fully tap. We thank you for the blessing of those who help others heal. Be with caregivers and physicians as they seek to provide the best care possible. Give them not only wisdom and empathy, but also assurance that they can rest with you when the burdens of caring for others become heavy. God, we ask that you comfort those who are in hospice care, including Laverne and Dorothy, and that you be with those who are homebound. Our prayer is that they feel your grace surrounding them. Give respite and assurance to their loved ones. We lift up those who are in the hospital and those who are facing surgeries, including Jim and Marva. Give them patience, faith, and strength as they depend on others to help them heal. In faith, we lift all of these things to you, O God, knowing that you hold each of us in your love. So it is that we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
How do you give to this church? We give to the work of the church through our time. Volunteer to serve on a committee. Join the marksmen. Start a new class. Volunteer in the pumpkin patch. We give to the work of the church through our prayers. How do you pray for our church and for our world? We give to the work of the church with our presence. We show up. We embody Christ in the world. We give financially to the work of the church. Your financial gifts enable us to do great things in our community and around the world. Use the QR code, go to the website to give online, mail a check, or stop by the office to leave a financial offering. But this morning, I'd like to invite you to hear one of our church members' story of the gift that giving can be. Let's hear.
Good morning and welcome. My name is Don Booth, and this morning I want to speak briefly on behalf of the 2022 Stewardship Campaign. In particular, I want to talk about two aspects of my church life that are near and dear to me, service and giving. I first learned the joys of service as a teenager near Tampa, Florida, when my small United Methodist Church decided we would build our fellowship hall ourselves without taking out a mortgage. I spent almost every Saturday morning for more than 2 years learning how to mix concrete, build a small section of block wall, and help put up a plank timber roof. I worked with my dad and my other friends and their dads and some moms, and discovered how much fun one could have working with friends on a common goal for your church. As I grew older, my youth fellowship group would participate in small mission trips in our community. After I graduated high school, I went to a local university, lived at home, and became what we called a commuter student. I continued attending church, and in my sophomore year of college, our pastor nominated me to be chair of our pretty small administrative board. Not only did that surprise me, it also surprised a whole bunch of adults. However, my pastor firmly believed that new leaders can and should start at a young age, and he gave me a wonderful opportunity to learn how to run a meeting. Fortunately for me, everyone on the administrative board knew me and not only gave me some pointers, but also kept their own counsel sometimes when they disagreed. Through these experiences as a teenager, 20-something, I gained wonderful training in serving both my church and my wider community, something that I continue to this day. My introduction to the power of giving also began as a high school teenager. Like most children and youth, we always had a quarter to put or two to put in the collection plate at Sunday school. In my teenage years, I continued to learn as I watched my parents and other older adults and their giving habits, and began learning the concept of giving a percentage of my income, small as it was, until I had a real job. Then in my junior year of high school, our church congregation had a special meeting after the service to figure out how we were going to continue our fellowship hall construction. It was time to pay for the laminated arches for the roof. They were due to be shipped the following week, and we had not yet collected enough money to pay for them. The father of one of my good Wyeth friends got up in the course of the discussion to address those that were present. He gave what has probably been one of the most inspiring witnesses on giving and faith that I have ever heard. He explained that he and his wife had moved their family of four from Ohio to our community 3 years before because he was having trouble finding work. He further explained that they basically went out on faith, packed up their belongings in a U-Haul, and moved to our town without having a job. They lived in a motel for several months while he found work. It was scary and uncertain, but they went out in faith and never looked back. My father's friend did eventually find a good job. The real nugget of faith, though, was how they gave their gifts to church. They had been tithers for a number of years before they moved, and after moving to Florida and needing months to find a job, and then moving forward securely, they never stopped tithing, no matter how much or how little. He then called on all of those present to consider how much we could find in our hearts and our budgets to give at this specific moment to pay for the fellowship hall arches that were coming. This was such an impactful moment for me in learning about faith and giving. Before our arches arrived the following week, we had collected more than enough to pay for them. In fact, we collected enough to pay for the rigging crew to come and install them. It took me a decade or two to work my giving up to a full tithe, trying to give a fixed percentage each week and increasing that percentage each year. I discovered that as my giving increased incrementally over this time, my faith increased by leaps and bounds. I also discovered, as my father's friend witnessed to us that day, that whenever we have the faith to tithe, that God does indeed make all things possible. Almost never in the way I expected or desired, but always just exactly what I needed at the moment. All these many years later, tithing is as natural to me as going to worship and serving. And just like my father's friend, I have never been without what I truly needed, though there were times where I surely wondered what would happen the next day. The gifts of serving and giving have been given to me by God and family and even nature. For those of you who know me, you know how much I love serving others. I try to do it without being seen or noticed most of the time, but in every moment I take great joy in doing such things and in being able to witness to others. On the other hand, most of you don't know that I'm a tither, because that is not usually important. But it is important for everyone to know what great joy tithing can bring, and so I offer my witness today to give each one something to think about in your faith journey. Serving and giving and faith are all integral parts of my core and have given me hope and strength when times have been difficult, and sometimes even more so when times are good. May God bless you and keep you.
Thank you for your gifts to the church. Let us pray. Holy and loving God, thank you for the privilege it is to give to others. Use the gifts that we give, our time, our talents, our resources, our finances. Use them to spread your love and forgiveness throughout this world, beginning right here at home. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen. I invite you to sing our closing song.
And I will sing of your great love.
Into this week, I pray that you go as gift givers, go giving to others as abundantly as Christ has given to you. Go knowing that all that we have comes from God, and we can share with others abundantly. Go in the name of God, our Father, His Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to sing our Shalom.
Shalom, my friends.